Welcome to the Conflict Consortium virtual workshop. We're very pleased to have Anna Brasich with us today, and she's going to be talking about her work in progress with a working title of the project is Friend or Foe, Conflicting Identities, Guiding Altruism. And Vanessa, if you would get us started with some comments.
All right. Thanks, Will. So my name's, for introduction's sake, Vanessa Leffler. I'm an assistant professor at Middle Tennessee State University. And I want to start off my comments to Anna, just thanking her for this paper. I'm always excited to see research that's using experimental methods in international relations. And I think this is a good representation of how this methodology can be used to answer really salient academic and political questions. So my comments primarily have kind of two big points and then a couple of questions for clarification and perhaps thinking about the data a little bit further. So I'll start with the minor point that I have about your theory development. And this may be an artifact of the literature that I'm not as familiar with, but a lot of the literature that you're reviewing is finding this distinction between in-group and out-group, and how if you can recategorize to adopt the superordinate identity that you can kind of cover some of these in-group, out-group tensions. But the examples of the literature that you're drawing from are pretty specific. So you have Burundi and Nepal, and it wasn't clear to me in those cases who the in-groups and out-groups are, especially like in Burundi and Nepal, where some of the findings were about the pro-social behavior of voting and participation in government. And I'm curious to know who's imagined as the out-groups in those settings. And I bring this up because it connects to me to the kind of the one of the bigger thoughts I had about this paper, in that I wonder if it's a possibility that in-group, out-group is not a binary distinction, but a spectrum, that I have kind of out-groups that are more similar to me than others. And I think that is something that's a possibly salient issue for the population that you're studying, because as you note, the population in Serbia and in the countries that you're investigating, you know, are Serbs, Croats, there's Muslims. And I wonder about the proximity of the sense of out-grouping. I know for Muslims in this context, they don't always perfectly identify with Arab Muslims, but I wonder if, you know, Muslim Serbs might see themselves somehow closer, despite the distinction in this setting, than maybe like, you know, in-group, out-group. I also worry too, in this in-group, out-group, I guess treating it as a binary, is that even in Burundi, where it is an ethnic civil war, at the end of the war, they're all still living in the same country. But this out-group setting seems very different, where it's really foreigners who are entering the country. And so that might be a wider gulf to bridge than maybe it was for Burundi or Nepal. And I wonder if you can maybe find more literature or maybe tease out that spectrum of in-group, out-group to help give me a sense of how the recategorization can possibly cover the difference in this case. My other major comment for this paper, and this is probably unfair since this is kind of really early work, is in the overall framing of the paper, I really feel like you're missing an opportunity to get people excited at the front end. Because to me, what was interesting about the dependent variable that you're investigating, whether Serbs were more likely to exhibit this pro-social altruistic behavior or not when different parts of their identity were cued, is that this group would seem to be most primed right now to exhibit this pro-social behavior. Because I was thinking of the broader policy question of why is it that Western European countries seem to be more open, or at least maybe specifically Germany, but Western European countries seem to be more open to refugee resettlement than the Eastern European countries, including Serbia and Croatia and the Slovak Republic. And I thought what is particularly interesting about this question is that given the previous experience that most of these countries had with a massive refugee flight, it was Western European countries who previously bore all the costs and these Eastern European countries who were actually the beneficiaries of this. So I might think automatically that Serbs would be already inclined to, you know, have had the positive benefits of being displaced. So, you know, they might be more inclined to accept, you know, people who are displaced because, you know, they've already been kind of the beneficiary of this system. But in fact, that's not the case when we look at attitudes towards refugees. And so I think, like, I don't know, motivating that puzzle a little bit more could get a lot more excitement out of ultimately your finding that when, you know, at least your preliminary finding that when we prime this displacement identity, we're still not getting this pro-social behavior. So what is it about this context that, you know, when you've been the previous beneficiary of others' generosity, you're not paying it forward, essentially. But when you're aware of the costs of altruism or pro-social behavior in this setting, you seem to be more open to it, as in the German case. So those are kind of two big comments that I would have on the theory development. I wish there were some better reflection on the in-group out-group gap. Is it an absolute gap, or is it, could it be imagined as a spectrum? And what possibilities could that have for the population you're studying? And I think you can get a lot more leverage out of the framing. I have a few smaller comments though, and really these are questions that could be clarified. So I've been using them even interchangeably in my comments here about altruism and pro-social behavior. And this might be just your vantage point, but I know between biology and psychology, there's a distinction where altruism is being generous to someone at a cost, and pro-social behavior is a costless generosity. So when you get to your testing, your dependent variable is really I don't know whether to interpret as a costless generosity or if it is a costly generosity. I mean, since I'm thinking the big thing is like the survey respondent never sees the money. They don't get it tangibly. So their sense of loss or their sense of cost might be misplaced. So I don't know if you want to be more consistent on altruism versus pro-social behavior, but that might help in kind of maybe not getting that biological behavior person who's like, this isn't altruism because there's a costless positive behavior. I also had a follow-up question about the population you're studying. So since this is an online survey, I inferred, you said the population represents Serbian computer users. And I wondered if one reason why your preliminary results don't show a substantial or significant difference between those who got the nationality prime and those who got the displacement prime is because computer users might be on average more cosmopolitan than non-computer users in Serbia. And I don't know if there are, you know, population differences of maybe those who were displaced in the war and who are having to be computer users. So some more discussion on that could be really helpful. And then the last comment I had that goes back to the gap on in-group and out-group is, in your population, I'm wondering if you're going to be able to eventually tease out any subgroup differences, such as Muslim Serbs and non-Muslim Serbs. I know you have Christianity as described as one of your variables, because I think there could possibly be a factorial element of, if you were a Muslim Serb who is displaced, you might eventually exhibit this stronger pro-social behavior if you get the displacement prime. And so that would be something to investigate once you have a better sense of what your data are going to be. But I really think this is work that would capture, a lot of attention just, on the virtue of its uniqueness. But I think it also potentially addresses a really interesting question of the kind of ongoing tension between Western and Eastern European countries. So thank you.
Great. Thanks so much. Anna, if you would give you a few minutes to respond, and both Vanessa and Carly, the queue is open if you'd like to get in line.
Thank you so much. You can hear me? Yes, good. Vanessa, thank you so much for these comments. They're great. So I can speak to some of them better than to others. So let me see, I'll just go in order. So your first comment on it being a spectrum, it's certainly a possibility. The literature that I use right now doesn't actually speak to it, so I'll have to do some more research to be able to do that. Given what I put in the survey, I might be able to speak to that a little bit, because I have a set of questions that talk about, how do you feel about Serbians? How do you feel about Bosnians? So, and I have enough groups there, including the group that I'm looking at, so that I can maybe, I can speak to maybe if there is a spectrum, we may be able to see it in terms of closeness. So that's based on what I have, and the survey's done, so at this point, I'll work with what I have, but I think I can speak to that a little bit. Honestly, with Burundi and Nepal, these examples, I use them primarily to really talk about prosociality and trauma. So that was sort of the primary use for putting them in the paper right now, but I'm gonna go back and take a look and try to be a little bit more specific and careful about that. So that's a great point, and I'll be looking at more literature to be able to build it up. Your point on the difference between having to live with an outgroup and not having to live with an outgroup is great. Thank you. I didn't think of it this way, and it's very useful. Okay, your second point on framing, that's excellent. I was actually going to ask you what you thought about how I could frame it better. So this is really quite welcome. Thank you. Let me see if I wrote more. Nope, that's pretty much it on the framing. I really liked it. Your questions, the bio-psych distinction, I really use the psychological. So I think I need to be clearer about that. It's really just behavior benefiting others. I don't work cost into the definition at all. But in terms of what they are told when they sign up for the study, they are told that they will earn 800 dinars, which means that they know that this belongs to them, that it's theirs. So they actually sign up essentially on the condition of knowing that. And all of these surveys always pay the participants, right? So it's kind of expected they'll get paid, right? So the way I actually saw it, I grappled with it a little bit, but decided to do it nonetheless. As they get through a sort of, a few questions, and then suddenly now they're expected to give up the money, right? So I would be maybe a little taken aback or upset given that I expected to get a whole 800, but so there is some cost to it, but as regards to the definition itself, I don't really work it in, but I have to be more specific. Thank you. Serbian computer users, they may be more cosmopolitan and younger, you're right. But looking at their answers on how Serbian they feel, right? It's sort of at 4 out of 5. It's a strong feeling. I will be able to speak to that with two things. I also asked them how they feel as a woman, as a man, or as a parent. So they will sort of provide a little bit of a basis for comparison. But I also have this other question, the last question of the treatment that everybody answers, whether or not they actually got the nationalist treatment, which is, what does it mean to be Serbian, right? And then they write their answers. And those answers are actually quite specific. So that will let me give a qualitative answer to the strength of feeling, right? And generally, I see so far a lot of strong feelings that are in either direction. Either they're really disappointed with their country or they feel very, very proud. For a Slovene, it's quite interesting because I don't think Slovenes would answer this way, just, you know, as a comparison. For subgroup differences right now, I don't have enough people. We'll see what happens. I have a feeling that I might not even have enough by the end, but we'll see. But I'll be looking at those. Oh, one other point that I remembered. The need to compare to other places, with your point on framing, right? Comparing your response to places, to people who have not gone through such displacement, right? I'm considering adding another population to the survey. Possibly, you know, Slovenia is an easy example. It comes to mind because there's a lot of the same sort of history, right? But there's no war experience. You know, I could go to other places too, maybe sort of a regional comparison, you know, parts of the former Yugoslavia that never actually saw war. But you know, Slovenia is the easiest example because we actually really didn't. I mean, it was a 10-day war. But so that's one possibility. Or I could actually go and try to do it in Germany. That's another possibility, right? Just to get an actual number to the difference. Yes, I'm going to mute.
Yeah, Vanessa.
Let's see. Yeah, so... And I don't mean to like top on you, but I think the thing that I wanted to emphasize with the frame is, and I think if you can compare, that's always great. But I'm thinking of, you know, these countries as a most likely case. If you're going to find any evidence of your recategorization hypothesis, you're gonna find it here because, I mean, you're kind of getting the double benefit, right? So these are people who have been displaced, so they've experienced the benefit of people who have shown them altruism. So they get the displacement identity so they can bridge that out-group, in-group barrier, but then they also, you know, are aware of what altruism towards displaced people can do. I think if you're gonna find it anywhere, you should find this effect here, which I think makes your preliminary result all the more interesting, that, you know, of a group who has this gap and should already be aware of what this policy can do to remedy the problem, you know, like that I think is the really interesting thing. I'm thinking of in the comparison of Western and Eastern Europe because of the bigger political debate, but I think if you were gonna find this displacement recategorization identity anywhere, you should find it here.
Okay, thanks. Anna?
So I forgot to say that I am planning on actually running, well, one half of this survey on Serbs who were not displaced. So that might actually be even better to speak to the point, I think, that you made. And I'll be probably doing this this spring or summer. So any feedback on that would be great, even though, I mean, I can't act, you know, parts of the survey will stay the same.
Okay, actually, that my first point, so I'll go ahead and jump up. It wasn't clear to me that all of the respondents had in fact been displaced, but that is true? Okay. I guess I missed that, but you may wanna, since one person missed it, you may wanna look at how you clarify that because yeah, that makes a huge difference. Okay, so I'm good there. Carly?
Hi, Okay, so do you want me to give all my comments like discussion style how Vanessa did, or do you want me to focus on one comment at a time? And then...
Yeah, one at a time.
Okay. Great. So what I will start with is just by saying that a lot of the mechanism underlying this claim that displaced people might be more altruistic towards other displaced groups is essentially, you talk about it as a superordinate identity, but it also could be discussed in the form of empathy, that basically they're able to empathize in a way that people that have not been displaced or people that are not reminded of that displacement, in the case of your experiment, are able to do. And there's a lot of interesting work going on in empathy right now, and empathy and public opinion, specifically towards immigration, which is going to be relevant, even though it's, you know, similar to refugee issues. So some work you might want to look at, I think it's in progress, like some working papers that have been going around. Nick Valentino has some stuff on this. Leonie Huddy has some stuff on this. That work tends to talk about empathy as like a dispositional trait, right? So they're looking at like people that are more empathetic versus people that are less empathetic, and how does that impact their, you know, policy preferences and things like that. Here you're talking about situational empathy, right? That it's like whether you've been through this experience or not, or whether you're reminded of this experience or not, and how that impacts it. And I think it's really difficult to have a discussion about altruism without a discussion of empathy. So I think it would help the paper to be in there somewhere. And then related to that issue is once you start talking about empathy, emotions become really wrapped up in that discussion. I have some ideas. So you had a manipulation check, right, where you saw that the reminding of displacement worked really well. The reminding of national identity didn't seem to move people that much. And I have some ideas as to why that is, and I think it's because the national identity questions don't trigger the emotions associated with national identity. For example, national identity tends to be emphasized under situations of threat and fear. And a lot of attitudes towards refugees and immigrations are hypothesized to come from feelings of threat or fear that these outgroups are going to bring in. So while your dispositional questions do indeed prime the sense of empathy or sympathy for other displaced people, your national identity primes might not be kind of priming the right emotional affiliation with identity. And so that might be one thing to think about, is integrating these kind of emotional aspects of kind of empathy versus fear into the paper.
Okay, thanks so much, Carla. Carla.
Can I go? Okay, so this is great. I think, okay, so I don't have an emotional manipulation check, and that's bad. But thank you for bringing it up. I'll see how I can deal with this. I do actually have questions on empathy, so I can speak to that. I ask questions about, you know, feeling sad, feeling angry. So I think I can easily fold that in, and I'll be looking to do that. Thank you.
Okay, great, okay, great. Let me go ahead and jump in. And I'm actually going to piggyback, small point, but piggyback on a comment that Vanessa made earlier with respect to pro-social. And in particular, I wonder if you want to be careful in the manuscript about whether you talk about pro-social behavior or pro-social attitudes. And, you know, ultimately it becomes behavior. Because, I mean, I would personally code, you know, playing a dictator game and giving some money up as behavior, right? But early on in the paper, we don't know that's going to happen. And so I found myself thinking, wait a minute, she's going to be asking a survey. Right? So those of us who are used to seeing a lot of the surveys, you know, do you plan to protest? Do you, you know, I was anticipating that. I shouldn't have been, but I was. So I think, and this is a very small thing, but when we're, you know, once the study itself is in good shape and we're presenting, I think small things, particularly if there are a handful of them early on, can get multiple readers to start seeing different things and developing different expectations over a paper. So I think even though it's a really small thing, it's something that could make a difference in once you actually get to submission, which is a way down the road. But so I just encourage you to sort of, you know, make sure you know where you are in the attitude versus behavior thing, you know, and then make sure your usage is clear throughout. And if you're gonna go behavior, which is what I would imagine, signal early, as early as the abstract perhaps, but definitely in the intro, that, you know, you are in fact looking at behavior, and here's why we should believe you. Carly, you had some others, I think, and Vanessa, you've pretty much made your comments, and so is that right? Okay, we'll just jump in, you know, with two fingers, and we'll just kind of keep going back with the comments that Carly and I have.
Sure. So my next comment has to do a little bit more with survey design and power and things like that. So first of all, you talk about null results, but I think it's way too early to say you have null results. You know, you might get results. But if you don't get results, I think some of the reasons you might not get results might have to do with survey design. So you're purposefully being really, really conservative in the way that you test these effects. And so your manipulation is really, really small. So I've, you know, experienced some of these issues in my own experimental studies that I've run recently, is that a lot of people skim surveys, a lot of people answer survey questions really quickly. You want to really hit them over the head with the manipulation, like in multiple different ways, multiple different times, to try and get differences across conditions. And I'm not sure if you'll have the money to kind of rerun like a replication study of this. But if you did, one thing I would recommend is maybe kind of trying to hit them over the head with a treatment a little bit harder. Like, it could be some kind of article that they read which talks about how, you know, displaced people have an obligation to help future displaced people versus, you know, displaced people that are Serbian, you know, now have a responsibility to protect the nation, you know, and those are like two different kind of primes, and like just really hammering it in with kind of big box quotes, big article headlines, a big picture, stuff like that. That's just from like a design kind of perspective. And then another comment on the design, I noticed that a lot of the moderators that you talk about are actually tested after the manipulation, which isn't a problem with all of the moderators, because some of them don't change, they're pretty fixed, but some of them might be affected by the manipulation itself. And so in future iterations, I would probably do test almost all the moderators before the manipulation, and that might also help address the point that you brought up, which was like they sign up for an 800 dinar survey and then immediately are told they don't get 800 dinars. They might be a little bit less upset about it if it comes a little bit later in the survey. Okay, I'll leave those methods questions there for now.
Anne, would you like to respond?
Yeah, with the treatment strength, I've gotten mixed responses. So some people giving feedback have actually said that my treatments were too strong. So up until right now, right, my dominant thought was actually, okay, I did too much over the head treating. It's interesting to hear your perspective. I guess I'm sort of, I'll wait what happens, and then maybe, you know, if I do have money left over, I might go with a stronger treatment. Good point about the moderators. I think the reason why I put things towards the back is because I didn't want people to be primed by other things, like thinking about their own conflict experience and so on. So that was my reasoning, but I think next time I'll probably rethink some of that at least.
Obviously the ideal situation is that you have this tiny little, this is like how the psych model operates. It's like in psychology, they do this like tiny little thing, like reminding you to wash your hands or something. And then it causes like these huge changes in attitudes. And then they basically like infer that if they had a bigger manipulation, it would have been even bigger. But I think in political science, it doesn't work as cleanly as in like the kind of pure psych lab experiments thing, because people aren't in the lab. They're not paying as much attention to the survey instrument. And so, you know, it's always good to try it like with the hard test first, you know, and then kind of see if you could ramp it up. And then in terms of the moderators, it's more expensive, but you could try a panel design where you test the moderators, you know, first, and then a week later come back and do the survey with the DBs.
I think we just got our first cat video in the CCBW, and I want to say that was awesome. I don't know. It's amazing that we haven't had more. It may not be the first. It's the first that I can think of right now.
I have two, so it might be a while. There might be another one that pops up.
Okay. and I want to bring up another. This is strictly presentational, and it may be, you know, my reading was less like survey respondents. Readers aren't necessarily as attentive as we want them to be, it may be that, but. You know, page 8, you title the section Survey Administration Sample and Blocking. But I didn't find a very strong discussion specifically about blocking, right? And this is one of these things where who's my audience? How well do people just get it because they're familiar with it versus they don't? How much do I want to really walk them through the, you know, the P's and Q's? So I want to assume that these are people who are not very familiar with these kinds of survey experiments or not. And of course, that's a moving target in a type of technique or method that is relatively new, right? In the beginning, you know exactly what you have to do because nobody knows what the hell you're talking about. After a decade or two, there's no, you know, your descriptions become much less, much more general, much less detailed because you do know, but as you move from one point to the other. And so that's something for you to, you know, think about that point specifically, but then just more generally. And, you know, it also depends on where you're submitting it in terms of, preparing slides and stuff for talks. It depends on where you're presenting it. Right, so you would hopefully not have the exact same set of slides if you were giving a talk to a group of people who did experiments all the time, as you would if you were giving a very general talk to an entire department, like a job talk kind of a setting. So that's just something I would encourage you to consider as you move forward with drafting it. And that's probably no response, is that right? If so, I'll go back to Carly, but if you'd like to respond, okay, let's go back to Carly.
Okay, so I'll just keep going with some of my comments. So some of it just was like some work that you might want to think about bringing in. And so some of the work I thought of when I read your piece was Kristen Munro's work on altruistic behavior during the Holocaust. And so this was like, and it dovetails really well with what your argument is. Basically, she does a bunch of interviews with people that hid Jews during the Holocaust versus those that collaborated with the Nazis. And she basically finds that the people that hid Jews had this kind of supraordinate identity, that basically they saw everyone as part of a human group as opposed to kind of separate national groups. And so they felt that they basically had no choice. They didn't even feel like they had agency in terms of their ability to help Jews. They felt like they just needed to because they were part of the group of humans. And so you might want to bring that in as like a helpful point. And then as a counterpoint, another piece of, you know, body of work that I thought of during your paper is work on Israelis and Israeli like treatment of Palestinians. And so a lot of the political arguments against Israel go something along the lines of, as, you know, Jews, you should be not, you know, not oppressing other national groups because you have such personal experience with it. And then the counter argument from a lot of people is that this experience of being treated, you know, terribly in the Holocaust or whatnot, it doesn't necessarily expand empathy to other groups, where it's more likely to result in-group protection in the future. And so that for Israelis or for Jews that have this experience of the Holocaust, they're not more likely to empathize with other people that are suffering genocide in the future. They're more likely to be super protective of their own group in the future. And that would kind of play to your national identity versus displaced person identity piece. I thought that might be a nice theoretical frame that you might want to bring up at the beginning, that basically these experiences of trauma can have one of two effects. They can make people, you know, more tolerant of other groups because they're more empathetic, or they can make people less tolerant because these people are basically traumatized and hypersensitive to threats to their own in-group.
I could jump in. That comment makes me wonder, Carly, and perhaps you, if you know, you can chime in, whether anyone's looked at generational effects, right? And so I'm actually going to now hop to a totally different question, but you look at, it's not totally different, right? So this comes up a lot in conversations about the Cuban population in the United States, right? There's a first generation effect and then a second generation and a third generation where their political attitudes are quite different. So I wonder if there is, Anna would be looking at first generation, right? She'd have no variance over that, but it still might be something of interest, probably more in a conclusion than anywhere else. But Carly, do you know if any of those studies have actually looked at in terms of not just foreign policy attitudes or whatever, but you know, actual altruism? Does anybody look beyond a single generation?
Yeah, so I'm not familiar with work that does specifically that. I think there's a lot of work in the field there's work in psychology that talks about intergenerational transmission of trauma. And so they look at like second and third generation Holocaust survivors, like children and grandchildren of Holocaust survivors, and look at like things like PTSD. So like actual people that like were not involved in the Holocaust can experience PTSD through the experiences of their parents or grandparents. And so I know there's stuff like that in psychology. And then in terms of political science, there's actually some colleagues here at Michigan are doing some work on, so Yuri Zhukov and Roya Talibova have a working paper out right now on repression under Stalin and how that impacts support for like Putin or lack of support for Putin. And there's my dog in the background. It's just like an animal house. But it's not about altruistic behavior. It's just about political attitudes. So I actually think that's like a really nice direction you could put in your conclusion because it signals future work that should be done that isn't really being done as much yet.
Okay, Anna? Nope, you're just listening? Okay, all right, cool. So let me bring up ethics. A very small question, but are the DNRs that they contribute really going to be given to a family? And is that family actually chosen by whatever the agency claimed would be? Okay, cool. It seemed like that would actually be hard to arrange. So I was a little dubious about it.
There is a caveat. It happens at the end. So, there are refugees in Serbia right now. I presume, you know, it may be, I might say, oh, once it's time to actually give the money to the family to pick someone who's been there for a long time. But I might not have control over that. But yes, we I won't be picking, but the agency will be picking, absolutely.
Cool.
I think Vanessa had two fingers earlier. I don't know. Do you still? Okay, maybe. Okay.
Go ahead, Vanessa.
Yeah, so actually what Carly was saying about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and the problem that Israelis might have in extending empathy to other repressed people actually really crystallized a thought I had written down. This is to bring up a really trivial thing, the title the subtitle of the paper is Conflicting Identities. And I had actually written a very small note of, is it the identities that are conflicting or the consequence of having multiple identities or multiple pieces of information that inform my identity? And what Carly said actually was kind of what I was thinking. It's like, I could be a displaced Serb, but what that means for whether I am altruistic towards refugees or not is really the conflict, not that I feel displaced or I'm a Serb. That those are the, that that's not, that may not be the conflict. The conflict is the consequence that I have both of these things that contribute to how I view the world. And that would be the example from the Israelis, that you could be both, you know, identify as a Jew and have a certain nationalism, and then also identify as being a victim of trauma. But that only causes a conflict where on one hand you might be protectionist and on the other hand you might be open. But the conflict comes at the policy extension, not that you're actually feeling somehow, discordant early. So like it's a really trivial thing to say, like conflicting identities. I don't know how I would rewrite the title, but that was something that did stand out to me.
Anna, any response?
That sounds good. I'm actually not really happy with the title. So I was going to ask you for suggestions if anyone had any thoughts. But this is a really good point, and you know, I'll think in this direction. Oh, I do have a point I forgot to say earlier. On the priming questions eliciting emotions. Turns out that the questions I ask Serbs are not, they make them upset. Which I did on purpose, partly. So you know, when I was running the pilots, right, people would like me, are you really serious about asking people this question? So, you know, to suggest something about soccer or burek, which is the, you know, the food that I don't know how many nations fight over, or some fight over, some don't feel so strongly, right? But so some of those things at least elicit strong feelings, not to the same extent probably as the displacement term, displacement at prime, but they do elicit some feelings. But again, I don't have a manipulation check, which is too bad.
Okay, great. Carly, do you have more?
Yeah, just to respond to that, if you wanted to, like in future iterations, make sure that the emotion stayed constant, like that the emotional direction stayed the same, you know, you could have like a question that is in both, that's like, recall a time that you were like injured or something like that. So that's like a common technique that they do in terror management studies, terror management theory. So the terror management theory is basically reminding people about death is gonna make them behave in different ways than if you don't. But reminding people about death is really unpleasant, and they don't want it to be like the unpleasant dimension that moves people. And so like in the other control condition, they remind people about like pain. So that could be something you could do.
Okay. I have, I don't know if you guys have seen this going around, I'm putting it up in the chat. But there's Denmark TV2 has put out in English a video that's called All That We Share, which is perfect for illustrating what you're doing, right? So they have a whole bunch of people come streaming into a room in groups, and like, this is that group, this is that group, this is the next group, and then they ask them questions, how many of you, and they give them a superordinate identity, and everybody who fits that category walks up and walks back, and right, and so they, you know, they create this "we are all one" sort of thing. And so, if you haven't seen it, at least you know for the coming year or 6 months or so, it's probably something you could use in talks. Maybe take clips from. I don't know that it would really be something to use in the paper, but. I wanted to share that. Anyway, it's pretty good. I recommend taking a look at it if you haven't seen it. Carly, do you?
So my remaining comments are all kind of pretty small, but since we're going through those, I'll talk about them. So the discussion of the moderators right now was unsatisfying for me. I know that right now you don't have the data, but I'm referring more to like the theoretical part of it. Right now it kind of seems like you just kind of picked those five moderators as like, oh, these probably matter. And like, let's see if there's heterogeneous treatment effects. And so with the current kind of methodological bent towards causal inference, that kind of, it seems like a little bit of like post hoc theorizing, like, oh, if I don't get a main effect, like, let me like look at these interaction effect models. And so when you package the paper, I would encourage you to have a little bit more theory upfront about like why you think these five moderators matter and the specific ways that you think they're going to matter, just to show that this wasn't like some kind of post hoc thing that you added. Or if it was, then talk about it in an exploratory fashion, like, you know, but why it's exploratory.
Thank you. Well, do. Yes. Go ahead, Anna. This is more the effect of having a draft that's clearly unfinished. So I will work on that. I did pre-register the study, right? So the you know, theorizing after the fact is not really going to happen. I mean, it might happen, but at that point, I will be quite open about it, right? Having this standard. So, but yeah, I will obviously work on this section and yeah, write it up.
Oh, and that's cool. And of course, this is just a draft that you're circulating for the purposes of getting feedback. But since you have pre-registered, you definitely want to tout that on the title page. And then of course, obviously also discuss it either in the body or in supporting information, or you know, however you choose to do that. But I would definitely put it on the title page as well. Well, that is what I've got, and so I don't have more to add. I think Vanessa is going to be right back in just a second, but maybe Carly will stimulate some things that we can jump in on.
Sure. So I was wondering if you did a power analysis. Another reason you might not have an effect is just because the effect size is pretty small, and 400 participants, maybe it's too small, or if you thought about that.
I did do a power analysis. I mean, you know, granted, the effect size I used probably was larger than what I'm getting. But so I'll see how this works out once I have all 400. If it looks like I just need more power, I think at, you know, at that point, looking at the data, I might be able to say, you know, what the chances are. And if it looks like I do need more power, I could keep it going. No, try keep adding it, since now it's sort of a you know, it's, I initially wanted to collect this in one go, but didn't get enough people. So now we're not right now doing another push, but we will be once it gets a little warmer. You know, I think we might just keep going if it looks like there's just a power issue. But I did do an analysis.
Yeah, and I think, yeah, I end up getting a null result. That's also really interesting to show that basically reminding people of their own displaced past has no impact on increasing their support for future displaced populations is really interesting, and a, you know, sad, but an interesting, good and cool result. But, you know, with our profession, null results are always harder to sell. And so basically, like, if you have a higher number of participants and you're still getting a null effect, you know, people are going to be more likely to believe that it's a result of the real world and not a result of your sample size or something like that.
Yeah, boy, I had something I was going to throw in there and my mind just went completely blank. I was just going to ask if you would, Anna, talk to us a little bit about how the survey is done. There's a little bit, but of course it's just a brief discussion paper. But I mean, and I'm curious, why would weather make a difference if this is an online survey, right? But how are you doing your recruiting? And when you say I could open it and do more, what's that a function of? And and wouldn't that, I mean, when you pre-registered, did you not talk about sample size or time? You have to start worrying about history effects or other sorts of effects if you, you know, at least potentially. So just curious if you could talk a little bit about those issues and if you have any questions that you'd like feedback for us, we can, you know, try to offer it.
Okay. When I starting this, right, we thought that it was going to work out in just one shot, but it ended up not. So the sample is essentially recruited on Facebook through this firm, and so this is how they're recruiting. So we did the initial push end of summer, not end of summer, sort of midsummer, I guess. And I didn't want to do anything in the winter because times are tough right now for refugees, especially those in Serbia, because it's cold. So I don't want the winter condition to influence, you know, empathy. Because I feel like there I could actually get a big, you know, I mean, it would be interesting. It's just not what I've set out to do.
It's because you did your first summer.
Yeah.
I got that.
Yeah. But then of course I will have to control for the wave timing. I mean, at this point, you know, it just didn't work out the way I thought it would, or the way the firm actually thought it would either. So it's not, you know, it's not something that they would say, oh, it's not going to work. They were sure it was going to work. But now, you know, we're sort of left, okay, let's wait and let's just do another push, but I don't want to do it in the winter because I think that will mess things up. If you have thoughts as to how I could, you know, or you know, other ideas, on this specifically, that'd be great.
I have no idea what proportion of Serbs was, experienced forced migration, was internally displaced or became a refugee. I imagine it's not very high in percentage terms. And so I'm curious if that's could be potentially playing a role in recruitment. And if so, is that something that you guys considered, or am I just wrong that it's really quite a large percentage?
We considered, yeah. It's actually 10%. 10% of the Serbian population currently has experienced displacement into three wars. So it's not as small as we would think, right? So getting 400. So they were confident they were able to get enough in their first panel. We did consider it, and it didn't seem like a big problem, but for some reason there's just not as much interest.
So I would just not say the word representative at any point in the survey. Like for me and for a lot of people, it's not a deal breaker that it's not representative. Like, people understand you're working with a difficult sample, and it's okay that it's like recruited by Facebook and things like that, but it's not representative. And so like once you introduce that word, you get all sorts of like expectations of what the sampling procedure was. And I think it just is confusing for the audience. I think it's fine that it's not representative, that it's not fully representative.
So the reason I said that was because the firm says it is, based on their own, you know, whatever they have, their own standard. I can easily take it out.
Like, I'm just thinking about, like, so I do some work in American politics as well. And like, so, I mean, obviously in American politics, there's like much bigger standards of what's representatives, because there's so many different survey firms doing that kind of work and things like that. But like, to do a representative sample in the United States, for example, will cost like upwards of like 10 to 15 grand. Whereas to do like an online sample where people just select in, it was like $2,000 or something like that. And so there's really like very systematic differences in the way that a representative sample is run, at least in the US context. And I imagine, I mean, the method would be the same everywhere. The feasibility of that would be different. So that's why I think people will be understanding and won't care that it's not representative. But if it's representative, they'll want to know why, and specifically why you think it's representative. And I don't think, I mean, unless you have other information from the survey firm, but from what I've heard so far, it doesn't seem like it's representative.
Yeah, okay, so I'll get the information they have, and then I'll decide whether I want to put it in or whether I want to just take the whole thing out.
Hey, Carly, what's the hound's name, and does he or she want Carly time or FaceTime on the virtual workshop here?
Her name is Penny, and she's driving me crazy. She's jumping all over me, and she wants Carly time, but it's fine. You can just ignore her.
Okay, that's pretty good. Yeah, actually, go ahead, Anna.
So I had a question on framing, not necessarily just framing, but is there any other work in political science specifically that you think I should put in? Because right now it's a little psychology heavy, and you know, I would like to build it up a little bit.
Yeah, Carly mentioned Kirsten Monroe, and I should have thought of that. The other thing I would take a look at, I would look at, Rick Wilson, you know, some of the experimental people, I'm almost sure Rick has something on altruism, but he may not, just do search the APSR, the AJPS, PRQ, JOP, maybe political psych, for altruism, because there is stuff. I have not paid enough attention to have a strong sense. I mean, I didn't think of it, but I do know the a lot of the work that Carly was referring to. So there definitely is. You'll just have to see what various arguments and findings and how you can speak to them, because I can't reasonably characterize that. Vanessa or Carly, any? Yeah, Anna?
So Rick Wilson does have a piece on, and it's in former Yugoslavia. And what's interesting there is that they find differences in how, so it's Bosnians, Croats, and Serbs, I think it's all three. And they find differences in altruism across the groups, but they're not really big, right? So their surprise is that altruism sort of went up fairly quickly, or even went up, they didn't know what it was before, but that it's, you know, that it was at that level was surprising. So I think that might be good to put in sort of as comparison, because that also speaks to Vanessa's earlier point, I think.
Yeah, Carly and Vanessa, if you have something, jump in.
So it depends to a certain extent who you want your audience to be. So like, for example, if you're submitting this to an IR, like a JCR, JPR kind of journal, then there's certain pieces of literature that you don't need to reference, or maybe you don't even want to because it gets you off your point. But if you're going to end up submitting something like political psychology, you'll get reviewers that are Americanists that do political behavior. And so they have like a huge body of work on like immigration attitudes and group identity and how that plays into immigration attitudes, intergroup threat, empathy, like I mentioned before. And so if you're planning on submitting to that kind of a journal, like any kind of general audience that crosses out of the IR subfield, then there's like a lot of related work. It's not, the DV isn't altruism. The DV is usually something like support for refugees, resettlements, or support for immigration or something like that. But it gets at this, the IV is similar in that it has something to do with identity and stuff like that.
And I guess to tap onto Carly's point, that's what I was gonna say too. I think the framing depends on where you expect to submit this, because I think, you know, if you, I was thinking probably, I don't know, you said, probably you said if you wanted to submit this to something like political psychology, you would emphasize more, I don't know, maybe I mentioned, you emphasize more like the support for refugees. I was thinking like, that'd be like more like the JCR, you know, political side, because that's like the policy question, like, you know, when do I open my doors to this potential source of conflict and violence and all these terrible things that Aideen says can, you know, come to your life when you, you know, open your borders to refugees. Whereas, you know, if we're emphasizing that the, you know, the DV is the pro-social behavior, then I'm thinking that language taps more into the political psychology people. Cause I was, I've not read, you know, a lot of stuff on this particular type of DV, but I have read a lot of that research on globalization and attitudes towards immigration. And I'm trying to remember now, like, which journals those were in, but I don't think they were political psychology. I think they were more of the mainstream field journals. So, but they were all like, you know, when do people, you know, support immigration, or when do they, you know, say, when do they basically lie about the reasons why they don't support immigration? So I mean, I think the framing depends on where you want to send it. And, you know, in my mind, I thought the interesting, I mean, because I'm not a political psychologist, I'm, in my mind, like, the interesting question is, you know, how is it possible that people who, you know, benefited from friendlier refugee policies from other countries in the past, you know, reject them in the present, which is more the political question than maybe the, you know, does my identity shape my pro-social behavior, which would be a psychology question.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think maybe you probably just need to put more emphasis on the political attitudes DV for both venues, like Vanessa was saying. And I also just thought of another guy that might be relevant for you, Michael Bang Peterson. He does work on support for welfare, which you could argue is like some form of altruistic policy. And he talks about things like group cues, like how deserving is the group versus how non-deserving is the group and stuff like that. And he publishes in political psychology a lot.
Yeah, and if I would add to that. I don't know that you're going to find much, but there was work that grew out of the sanctuary movement in the 1980s in the United States to offer sanctuary to Central American refugees who were here illegally, and lots of I think it were mostly churches. And people opened up their homes, and so it was a small movement, but there was a movement, and as a consequence, there were researchers who went out to study these people, and they were obviously taking a risk to provide sanctuary.
Thank you. That's great. So now that, you know, talked about. Depending on where I sent this, do you have any suggestions of where you think this might fit best?
So right now I would suggest like political psychology, especially since the dependent variable you're focusing on is altruism. If you wanted to shift it more in like a more political science, less interdisciplinary journal, you'd have to spend a lot more time on the political attitudes side of the dependent variable, which I'm not sure, you know, it could be interesting, but I'm not sure how interested you are in pursuing. I saw you had those questions in your survey, so maybe.
I could imagine, I mean, I think it depends a little bit on whether the result stays null. I think to the extent that the result stays null, it's going, you know, finding journals that are friendly toward that. You know, you might even think about, you know, something like Research in Politics, or another, you know, sort of newer journal that's of the ilk that, you know, where you're going to have some editors and referees who are familiar with the file drawer problem, and, you know, who are friendly toward pre-registration. Most referees still don't know what the hell that is, much less friendly toward it. So if you find an effect, I think that, you know, broadens things considerably. And I could see it being pitched. I mean, if you find an effect, you have the newsworthiness, and personally, I don't think that should matter a whit toward whether or not you can publish in major journals, but I do think that it does. And so I would be tempted to think about, you know, AJPS, APSR, JOP, but unfortunately, I think you would have to find that effect. I think, you know, in other words, I think that's a normative effect. You know, you could also think about the American Sociological Review, and I think ASR is more susceptible to that. This is a result we want to see problem. I mean, nature and science suffer from this enormously, but I think the American Sociological Review, in my opinion, looking through it, seems to be, yeah, there's certain findings they really like to see, and you have the potential to have that. So, you know, that's worth thinking about as it comes forward. You know, so till you're done and know what your effect is, I think that's going to play a role. And then, you know, I think Carly and Vanessa have really good suggestions on thinking about how, depending on venue, how do you really want to talk about it? Because it seems to me you do have some flexibility there. And what, you know, just this is very generic stuff. We've got to figure out, who am I talking to? What research, you know, literatures, trajectories, traditions do I situate this particular study? And I think you've got some options. Vanessa, do you have anything particularly you wanted to add there? Okay. Anna, do you have any, you've got, you know, we still have a few minutes. We don't need to take them, but if you have any other questions that you want to, three of us have read the paper, and if you want to throw our way, you're welcome to.
Thank you. Thank you for these suggestions. So another question I had is on how much you wanted to see about the Yugoslav conflicts. How much background would be useful? How much would be too much, given that it's past? What sort of stuff from the conflict would be most useful to see in terms of, you know, the experience of displacement, or, you know, maybe just the trauma part, or anything speaking to this conflict? How much would you want to see, and how much would be too much?
For me, I think I'm interested in stuff that's relevant, and I've seen, I'm probably pickier than a lot of other readers. I tend to skip those sections because I rarely find useful things in them. But what I really would have liked to have known is the 10% figure, right? So what are we talking about here? Which then will have back-end implications, right? So, because if it was 1%, well, that has an effect, but sort of who cares? It's not going to influence the experience of refugees in Serbia. You know, and you know, you might want to even put that in context, right? But if you don't find a result, then not so much. But if you actually find a result, then, you know, talk about, well, what are some other countries? So that strikes me as one thing that matters. I of course, am somebody who feels like I know a fair amount. I mean, most of what someone's going to tell me in a brief overview of the Serb involvement in the Yugoslav conflict is something that, yeah, I kind of know that already. But there are lots of readers who don't, right? So, but I think the guiding thing, I think what most people do poorly when writing these sections is ask themselves, what is important for the reader to know about this conflict with respect to my, you know, with what's coming down the line? we have this tendency to write, you know, what would be a Wikipedia entry, right? When did it start? And it's nothing wrong with writing that, right? But then just trim it accordingly. But that's my particular view. I don't know. Let's let the others weigh in and see if they have similar thoughts.
I can go, Vanessa, unless you want to start. So the comment that I usually get from reviewers, so for example, I do some work on Israel, and I always get like, well, so what does Israel mean for other countries? How valid is this in other contexts? And so if you could speak to like how Serbian context is unique, like every situation is unique. However, it has these aspects of it that means that we should care about it even if we don't study Serbia, is usually what I think is effective when you talk about the reasons why you're using that specific conflict.
Vanessa?
Yeah, I say I'll just go ahead and jump in and second what you said, Will, about the 10% number, because I was like, I know I read that section, but actually the percentages would be a lot more informative because you just give the raw numbers and it gives you one sense of scope, but you know, to know that it's 10% of the population, that's I think a different and I mean, in my mind, more compelling piece of information than maybe the raw numbers, especially because, like, offhand, I don't know the population of any of these countries. Thinking about what would be the most compelling way to talk about the magnitude of the issue. And I could also then fold over into what Carly said about, like, how it's similar or dissimilar from maybe other IDP situations. This is not going to have maybe the same magnitude as Syria or what Jordan is experiencing in terms of, you know, Syrian migrants coming to the country, but it will be very salient to a lot of other countries' experiences with displacement.
Okay. Anything else, Anna?
My last thing is in terms of the analysis, is there something in particular that you would like to see? Because, you know, my own tendency is to go to difference in, you know, the simple stuff. I like difference in means, and then I go to marginal effects. But so that's what I like. But I was wondering if there is something else that people would like to see that that I might not be thinking about.
You can get the you know, purists who don't want means, right, over ordinal. You're fine, because these are the dollar values, right, or dinar values. I mean, you have to be a real purist on the, So I know, but I'm a poor representative of a picky statistics person, which I think surprises some people sometimes, but I'm like, no, that was fine. Somebody's going to want, they'll probably tell you in their robustness, their requests for, show me that it's not this or show me in this, you know, blah, 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 blah. But what about you guys?
Well, yeah, that's the great thing about an experimental design is all of the kind of statistical thought and work goes into the front end when you talk about, you know, what you're going to block on and all those kinds of things. And then the statistical analysis has the virtue of being very simple and just doing difference in means. One thing that I always do is I check for balance across key covariates anyways. And just to present that, to basically demonstrate that I achieved random assignment on the things that I think are at least most important to have variation on. But in terms of the main analysis, this is, you know, exactly what you want. Difference in means and then a marginal effects to look at interaction effects.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say too, is the interaction effects would probably be the next place that I would go with presenting results. And only because people usually want to know, you know, characteristics of your population, regardless of whether they matter, but like men, women, age range, those types of things. Yeah, and especially if we're dealing in an area of empathy and altruism, maybe actually checking the gender interaction. I don't know, you know, with randomization, of course, like there should be no difference, but, you know, there may be something to explore just to footnote it or something. So.
Okay, great.
Great, thank you.
Absolutely. Well, I usually sign off by recognizing our discussants who take time out to read somebody's work and then hang out for, you know, over an hour. And of course, without that volunteer service, our workshop would never happen. So thank you both for taking the time and chipping in. And please consider submitting work in the future, and let people know we don't get flooded with applications. We send them out in December and July, which are not wonderful times to get people's attention. But we always welcome applications. And so, thank you, Anne, for sending yours in, and thanks to everybody for participating. Enjoy. Absolutely. Enjoy the rest of your day, everybody.
Thank you.